Welcome back, everybody, to Game 3 of IG versus Newbie. I did not think I was going to have the chance to say this after that first game, but IG coming back strong in Game 2 and pulling out a can of whoop-ass on Newbie, man. So let's go ahead and jump into Game 3. We already have the draft underway, and I can welcome in my co-caster once again. It's going to be the stats man, Nahaz, joining me on the mic this time around.
And once again, I am grinning like an idiot because IG opened with the same two picks that they did in the last draft. And I think that this is really when they're at their best, when they get Ferrari on that Ember and Chuan. And sometimes you'll actually even see Luo on that Mirana. Newbie do switch things up a little bit. They open up with the Batrider, which is a hero that obviously every team wants to pick up in this patch. He's by far the most banned hero. But at the same time, a lot of teams, including Newbie, they play him relatively infrequently, and so his record is not really that good. I think after yesterday's games, they're 4-3. The Morphling here is a little bit of an interesting pickup. Have you seen them play that hero?
The Morphling pickup from Newbie is seen. I think I've seen them before. It's definitely been doing well so far in the Chinese scene, but I can't say I've ever seen. No, I think I have. Okay. I think I've seen him a couple times, actually.
Yeah. So all right. So they are 5-1 in this patch when they pick up the Morphling, and yeah. Okay. So not surprisingly, it is going to be Hao that's playing that hero, and I like Morphling against the Ember Spirit just because he's a carry that isn't afraid to get involved in those mid-game engagements. He can do quite a bit of damage. He's fairly flexible in terms of where you put him on the map. He really wants, of course, either that safe lane, but he can do okay in a mid. We've even seen some teams run Morphling and Wisp with like a double bottle start, which is kind of neat. I don't necessarily think we'll see that here, but I think both teams have some nice options going into the latter part of the drafts.
Yeah, I think the last time that I saw them, I believe, was ESL. I believe they played a Morphling sometime in there. I don't know if they did well with it or not, but they did pick it up recently, at least in my mind. We're going to have a couple of bans coming out. Elder Titan as well as the Invoker was banned away by Team Newbie, while the Brewmaster and Tidehunter going to be taken out by IG, and they immediately grabbed the Nature's Prophet going into the second picking phase. So that means they're now going to have a lot of split push once again, and I'm a little bit concerned. Like, this Batrider pickup here from Newbie is going to be doing a lot of work for IG. I mean, you have a lot of squishy heroes that basically ensure that if the Batrider gets a lasso and is able to get the four staff off, the chances are that hero's done for, man. These heroes are so damn squishy. So I think both the Batrider and the Morphling are going to have plenty of opportunities to find pickoffs here on IG. If we do see a shotgun Morphling, I'm sure we will, but especially with three different squishy heroes already in the pool for IG. But you never know. Maybe we're going to see a bit more hard carry like the Scotty build on Morphling and should just try and angle be the right click beast. But all in all, I do favor Newbie's lineup a little bit more. I don't place that much credit into the Ember Spirit. I know that we've seen him rising in the Chinese scene, where he's definitely fallen off in the Western scene quite a bit. We're seeing the rise of the Ember Spirit a bit, but I don't really feel like he's consistently picked up in the 1-2. Then again, IG, if you do something well in Game 2, you might as well pick it up again for Game 3.
You've already got
that confidence.
Let's make a big distinction here. When I'm talking about the Ember Spirit in this draft, I'm talking about Ferrari. I'm not talking about the hero in general. I actually agree with you. There's a good reason, I think, that he's fallen off in the Western scene. He has stuck around in some ways in the SEA and the Chinese scenes, but this is all about Ferrari. I think the way Ferrari plays this hero is a level above what I've seen from just about anybody else out there. And so I think that's why you're seeing it from IG. I think really there really are only a couple of teams that would first pick an Ember Spirit right now in this game, and I think IG's one of them. The Disruptor, though, is a little bit of a surprise for me. What do you think the thinking is there?
Well, I'm not surprised IG grabbed themselves the Ancient Apparition. I was going to say, normally at this point, you look for support to set up the Mirana, but you already have the Ember Spirit as well as the Nature's Prophet, and that was something that IG demonstrated very well, is that they're still able to pull off the Mirana Arrow, even if it's their core setting up. because you've got the chains, you've got the sprout. They aren't the obvious abilities to set up the Marana arrow, but Chuan's good enough with the arrow to pull it off anyway. So instead of grabbing a setup hero, they grab the Ancient Apparition, which has been highly valued by them of late, and it is works exceptionally well up against a Morphling. But I do like the Disruptor pickup here from Newbie. It's going to be a great controlling hero. You've got a lot of squishy heroes on the side of IG. Pretty much anyone you get caught in the Static Storm, again, he's probably dead.
Yeah, you saw how well that they used that Invoker Sunstrike in the last matchup. And so I think in addition to countering the Morphling, I think that the AA is a pretty good pickup here. It does put a little bit of pressure on the laning phase. I feel like Newbie might end up with the stronger lanes here, depending on what we see in the last couple of picks. And by the way, I do have to thank a couple of folks in particular in Twitch chat for some feedback between matches. Apparently, you know, my day job, I give lectures. And so I may be a little bit too long-winded. So thanks for the feedback, guys. I will try and do that a little bit differently here. What do you think about the last two picks in the draft here?
Well, real quick, I'll just give you the same thing that Toby gave me. When I first, like, as a main caster going in, the first time I co-cast with Toby and, like, took over the cast, man, I'll just tell you the same exact thing he told me. It was like, hey, man, it's nice sometimes just to be able to sit back, take a break, and, you know, focus on the camera work a little bit. So it's all good, man. But Shadow Shaman being grabbed, I didn't expect this. I honestly expected, like, some sort of longer range initiator specifically for the Ember Spirit. If Shadow Shaman gets a Blink Dagger, it's great. But if Newbie don't do well in the laning phase and these supports start falling behind, especially the Shadow Shaman, I think this is a game where you have to have a Blink Dagger for him. But yes, it's not that easy because they don't have a very mid-game oriented lineup. So it's not like they go, oh, we automatically win team fights and we're guaranteed to take towers off the Shadow Shaman wards. It's going to be much harder than that. Whoa. And IG, well, you already had the Ancient Apparition, so why not? They grab the Faceless Void. Great synergy between these two. And also, one hell of a carry. I think Faceless Void is really going to be the carry going into TI4. I feel that his time is really now to shine. All of Dota 2, he's been kind of lackluster, but the kind of, like, steady buffs that he's receiving, both with the Chronosphere being better, the Time Lock actually doing more damage inside the Chronosphere, etc., etc. I think Faceless Void is now an extremely strong carry to be picking up, especially because he's a great utility hero as well.
That's exactly right. I think the last thing that you said is the key to that statement, that people have really caught on to the fact. You've seen Aghanim's moved up in his build order. People have really caught on to the fact that Faceless Void can get some things done earlier on in the game than thought. I don't know about this Spectre pick, man.
I think it's time to pull out your stats, man. How many times have you seen a Spectre and a Morphling picked up on the same team? This is one hell of a late-game lineup from Newbie.
Well, it is, and I think you're going to see from Newbie what EG has been doing, and that's picking Morphling and running him in sort of a dual mid or a semi-dual mid situation. But I really don't... Yeah, that's the first time, in this patch anyway, that you've seen Spectre and Morphling picked up on the same side. And yeah, you go back a couple of patches. It's been a while. It's been a while. So this is not... obviously, I'm already through 6.79 seeing zeros here. So yeah, it's been a long time since we've seen this combination. I don't really like it here. I actually think IG have the better draft, but I will say this: Newbie has surprised me before in terms of the combinations that they're able to put together. So I wouldn't be surprised to see something unconventional from them. The Shadow Shaman, by the way, a point that you made in the draft, Shadow Shaman really struggles against an Ember Spirit because his spells have such limited range, and he's already going to, in team engagement starting around 10 or 15 minutes, he's already going to eat a couple of sleight of fists before he's able to even get in position to cast his spells a lot of the time, and that's, you know, half his HP gone. Okay, they're going to send the Void mid. This is what I was wondering. When we were talking about Void carry, a lot of teams are running him in a mid role or maybe even an offlane role. Shout out to IX Mike because of that utility potential. So we'll see. I actually don't know if Luo or YYF, I don't know if he's as good on the Ember Spirit as Ferrari is.
Yeah, I will never discount the Faceless Void mid after I think it was both you and I watched that match where Void went mid up against the Viper, and I was like, whoa, Viper, yep, one of the strongest laners in the game, and he's going up against a melee hero. I'm not sure how I feel about that, but now I since we saw that Faceless Void actually win the lane, basically, he had more CS than the Viper, and ever since that, you know, I will never discount the Faceless Void mid. So apparently, again, feeling that that's going to be successful. It's going up against Morphling. Morphling, obviously, going to be able to do a lot of damage if he goes, you know, max agility here. But otherwise, I think, you know, things should be generally fine for Ferrari. He's going to play a little passive, just get his CS. They're mainly going to be focusing on the mid game. I can't believe Newbie drafted themselves such a greedy lineup, both in supports as well as cores. Batrider is the only non-greedy pickup I see here from Newbie. But apparently they felt that, like, IG just was completely outdrafting them going into the mid game, that maybe they just wanted to orient themselves for more late game power. But we'll see. I'm just most interested to see how they do going into the mid game and how they actually plan to address IG, who have incredible initiation, incredible power going into the mid game. How are they actually going to be able to deal with that and actually get the farm necessary for heroes like Spectre, Morphling, hell, both of their supports who need quite a bit as well?
Yeah, I mean, to me, this is really what... this is what you mean a lot of the time when you talk about an outdraft, is that I feel like one team, IG here, has just a lot more options. That I think if they get a lead during the laning phase, they can do more with it. And I think they still have adequate late game. So the Shadow Shaman's going to have to come help out here.
Faith is going to go down here as Moo actually still has a waveform. Moo will get that first blood. Exactly what Newbie need to do here is find those kind of rotations. Faceless Void is just not a hero who can take advantage of those sort of situations and output a lot of damage. It's one of his biggest downfalls is, really, he's severely lacking in damage unless he gets some good RNG from Time Lock. He's more utility-based going in to, even going into the mid-game, he generally lacks in damage most of the time. So in these early laning phases, he really cannot do the same as a Morphling can when it comes to threatening those supports. So well played by Newbie. I think they kind of have to do well in the laning phase here. Otherwise, IG, if they do well in the laning phase, they're going to have just, they're just going to steamroll over Newbie for the mid game. At least that's the way I see it. Maybe Newbie have some interesting plans in mind, but I honestly cannot see it with the two cores that they have, both the Morphling and the Spectre. They can do some work in the mid game, but they are never that powerful. They aren't heroes that take over the game early on.
Yeah, I still am running over in my head trying to really understand the thinking with the Spectre pickup. I mean, it's not, I guess I can see some arguments for it, but I feel like there are a number of heroes that would have been better. But going back to what we were talking about the sort of greed level of Newbie's lineup, Shadow Shaman is a very greedy support. But one of the ways that you mitigate that is he does have a, granted it's a channel, it's effectively a double disable, but he does have almost a 3 second disable on Shackles at level one. And so you can mitigate some of that greed factor by using him for a super early rotation as they did to get the first blood. And I think that's the difference. Again, it's a small thing, but that's the difference between a really, really great team and a good team, is that they're able to take these greedy lineups and they're able to sort of use the abilities earlier on to sort of mitigate the overall greed of their draft.
Take a look at the offlaners. All right now we have both of them playing pretty aggressively. I believe that the Furion is in the most danger here. As you can see, he's actually trying to get away, and the Glimpse does snag him. That means that level 2 Glimpse coming out will ensure the kill onto our Nature's Prophet. So well played by Newbie, as they actually have a push coming in as well. So that's going to be a lot of lost experience there for the Furion, where the Batrider was also playing just as aggressive, but an Ancient Apparition does much, much less than either one of those supports on the side of Newbie. The Disruptor is exceptionally strong once he hits level 3, thanks to that very long-range Glimpse. And then, of course, the Shadow Shaman, we already talked about him, his single-target disable is absolutely amazing. So.
Well, you mentioned that during the drafting phase, that they didn't really have an ideal clean setup for Chuan's arrows, but, you know, it's a Chuan Marana, so we kind of expect him to hit everything, but he was off in the jungle pulling there, so really no support to the lane, and Batrider is getting kind of all he wants down here on this off lane against the Radiant aggro try, where Prophet is sitting back by his tower being forced to play extremely careful because the Rasta does have a hard disable.
Ferrari, you saw the Morphling play a little bit aggressive there.
Yep.
Ferrari does have, as soon as he hits level 6, he may have a little bit of kill potential against the Morphling, but it's mainly going to depend on rotation. So I think you're probably going to see Chuan come over in, I would say, about 30 seconds to a minute. I would guess he would try and make a rotation because that Chronosphere is a free arrow, right? So even if you do our strength morphing, you're still that like just that amount of like burst damage from the arrow by itself, I think is enough to secure the kill on Mu, especially if he's already low like this. Bottom lane, they are chasing in for Xiaowei, but again, he's just abusing the Firefly as much as possible and easily dodging the arrows since there's no setup for it.
Well, the big thing here that you need, the effectiveness of Void's Chronosphere is really dependent on AA getting his level 6 up at a reasonable time, and that bottom lane hasn't gone it hasn't gone that badly, but it hasn't gone ideally for them. And so really pay attention to AA's level here, because I think that's going to have a lot to do with how successful Void is.
Chuan started heading for the mid lane. Radiant's, I was like, oh, score, got it. Just called it. But now he goes back to bottom. Looks like he's going to try for a kill onto Xiaowei. Again, they have to land the chains here if they want to be able to do it. Beautiful play from Xiaowei, hiding himself inside of the creep wave to make sure both the chains and the arrow do not have a chance of landing. That is just a brilliant play. Most heroes would panic there. Most players would panic and like, oh, I got to just run back to my tower. But if he gets hit by the chains and he's not inside of that creep wave, then the arrow is going to be able to land. It's an insured kill. So him being actually turning around there was the best possible decision he could have made. So well done by him. Ferrari now does have that ultimate. See how the Ancient Apparition is doing. Inexperienced, level 3.5. That isn't great, mainly because of the fact that Batrider's been intercepting so much of that pull experience.
Exactly. And this is, you know, people talk about this all the time. People talk about teams like EG, and in this case, Newbie, drafting really greedy lineups. And the key to it is you execute during the laning phase. I mean, I'm starting to sound like a broken record here, but that really is so important. Newbie's getting away with their greedy lineup because they're able to execute their lanes so well. I mean, look at just compare the Dire Tri-Lane to the Radiant Tri-Lane right now, and it's just such a stark difference in terms of what they've been able to accomplish.
Yeah, you could see Newbie have already taken a rather early gold and experience lead, just very slightly, but that could all change with just a couple of rotations here. You could see Chuan is angling. I think they're finally going for that Chronosphere arrow combo, but Mu is at full health here, and I'm less confident about them being able to get the kill at this point. I think they needed to maybe get Mu a little bit lower, you know, harass him up a little bit before they go for that kill. And I think Chuan agrees. He's actually going to be rotating around, trying to get out the Batrider again as he tries to defend the Tier 1 tower, but the rotation's already been spotted out, so it's so unlikely for Chuan to actually find a kill here. They may be able to claim Tier 1 just because Xiaowei is focusing on clearing through some stacks in the jungle, trying to get himself that Blink Dagger as soon as humanly possible. But still, they're even rotating the Furion here. They're fully committing to this push.
Yeah, but they're okay with that, right? I mean, the timing of that was Morana looping around behind. This is probably more about protecting the Tier 1 push. Is she going to react to the TP?
Well, I don't know. We have two supports here already. Could have some additional heroes coming in. Chains not able to land. Once again, the creep wave soaking up that disable. And we will finally have a teleport in. The Batrider is going to be coming in. Now, actually, the Spectre goes out as well. Attempt, Remnant away. Beautiful play there from the Ember Spirit. But Faith is going to be caught. They at least get something. I don't think they really expected too much to be able to grab the Ember Spirit. It would have required an instant shackles there from Banana, and or to hold the Ember Spirit. Even then, he could have still leapt away before the actual kill went out. So I don't think they really expected the Ember Spirit kill. That was just a greedy play, or just kind of optimistic play by them to try and get that kill. But at least they get Faith, and they also deny the tower, which is wonderful because there is Hand of Midas being built onto our Furion right now. So that influx of gold would have been really important for Furion. Obviously, the faster you get that Midas, the more effective you're going to be.
Yeah, I mean, I think that was great team play by Newbie there. They get the AA, which is something, right? And they deny the tower, and that's really important because one of the things that you can see happen when Batrider gets his level 3 or level 4 Firefly in lane and then rotates up to farm the jungle, all of a sudden your bottom Tier 1 tower is extremely vulnerable, and on the Dire side, that's really a critical tower. Newbie, I mean, they do let the tower fall, but they at least get something in the process, and that's just, you know, we casters talk about trades all the time, and that because that's really what Dota is all about, is making those trades, and I think Newbie really came up on the better end of that one.
Looks like we're seeing potentially double Midas. I mean, I suppose Ferrari could be just angling to finish off his treads, but with this amount of gold, you're expecting to see a Midas picked up by him, so Midas on him, as well as the Nature's Prophet. Ember Spirit's going to be going the more aggressive build. You're going to see him probably build the same exact items as the Spectre. And I like seeing this on the Spectre. I don't think this is a Radiance game by any mean. I mean, that is going for the hard carry Spectre. I think you need to come online as soon as possible. And even just Phase Boot Drums, with the extra damage that you get from Desolate, well, it looks like they're going to find a kill on San Sheng. Much needed there, as even the Glimpse just helping the Ember Spirit get him back a little bit. Spectre's actually going to pop his ultimate here. Looks like, well, he's going for the mid lane, where Faith is going to be caught by that dagger. Level 4 dagger is going to slow him up easily enough. And with the Morphling waveform over the top, the two heroes do burst down rather easily. That squishy support hero. And again, the supports are the big difference here for the two teams. IG, level 4 on both of their supports, whereas the Disruptor and the Shadow Shaman are about to pick up their level 6.
Yeah, you might actually see Spectre go Vanguard here after picking up the early Vitality booster, and this is one of the few times that...
barely gets him. San Sheng going to be blown up by that Remnant as YYF comes in. He's going to be held in, but Banana is costing his own life here trying to hold the Ember Spirit here, and it's not going to be worth it as he goes down. Double kill for YYF as he simply teleports himself away from the Spectre. Zhao Wei will be able to get a kill onto Chuan, but that was a much-needed kill, not only just for the Ember Spirit, but mainly, I would say for me, the experience given to that Mirana. So trying to get those supports, being a part of two kills like that is huge. Oh no, Nature's Prophet overextending himself, but no flame break for Zhao Wei. You're seeing this a lot now from the Mat Riders because of that sticky napalm change. I know, Nahans, you like to talk about it quite a bit. We're seeing more effort put into the farming capabilities, the Mat Rider, meaning we don't see any early levels of flame break.
Yeah, and I actually think that's a huge mistake. I mean, I think people don't appreciate how important it is even very early on to be able to stop a TP. And I think, for example, that's part of the reason why you've seen Dazzle fall off so hard. Just the removal of the mini stun from Poison Touch, it affects the number of lane combinations, particularly tri-lane combinations, where he's viable. And I think for Batrider, by along the same vein, you've got to be able to stop that TP there. You got to have that one skill point.
Yeah, Dazzle was a hero that IG picked up all the time. Never since that change, they never did. YYF is going to be held in place by the Static Storm. Again, so good versus the Ember Spirit. So they do force that rotation, but it's well worth it for Team Newbie. They grab a kill. IG trying to make the most of it. Immediately, the Furion teleports to the bottom lane and going to try and push that out. And Spectre does go through the Vanguard that you mentioned earlier. Still expecting a Drums for him as well. But that is going to allow the Spectre. He can max out the Desolate. As soon as he has level 4 Desolate, he's actually a really big factor in these team fights now. You can build the Spectre in that kind of way. You expect him to be more of a mid-game hero, but he actually is very effective about 15 to 25 minutes in if he builds like this, exactly, where he's really tanky and his right clicks are very dangerous.
No, that's absolutely right, and this reminds me a lot. For a while, you were seeing Na'Vi run a Spectre, Radiant's and they would basically just feed kills to Hovosh. They would draft a decent pickoff lineup with a fair amount of lockdown, and they would go in on somebody, lock that hero down, and Spectre would haunt in, and they just feed him the kill. And that was a great, to me, way to mitigate Spectre's biggest problem most often in these games, which is the fact that she can just be useless before 30 minutes.
It's all about usually whether or not your team is able to set up those times for you to use your ultimate, or if you're initiated on IG. They're not going to find how, or at least not yet. They do see him. Smoke is going to be revealed, and the ward was probably seen as well, but Hao is just not moving here at all, man. He is a statue. And maybe he didn't actually get seen. Chronosphere is going to be thrown out. Chuan waiting throughout the arrow for the last second. Now hits it. Starstorm on top. Ice Blast over the top. Will be able to land on Hound. That should shatter him there, especially with the last couple of right clicks. But what can Newbie get in return? They're going to get at least one kill. A secondary onto the Mirana. And now the chase onto Nature's Prophet, where the Spectre comes back into play. Didn't actually shatter. And that's going to be 3-0 there in the favor of Newbie. Well played. A good reaction there from Newbie. And just
really
a little bit optimistic.
Play
there from IG.
Yeah, optimistic is I think being a little bit too kind. That's a terrible decision by the Void and the Mirana there. I mean, you've got to, when you're gonna go for a smoke gank like that, way up by a tier 2 tower, you've got to make that happen right away, or you've got to back up. And I feel like there was a little bit of a kind of a dance going on there where they finally said, oh, hey, there's a hero. There's a Spectre. It'd be great if we could kill her. But by that time, I think the whole team was aware of what was going on.
YWAF already locking down Hal as the arrow sneaks on by. They're going to go for this tier 1 tower in the mid lane. At the very least, it's going to be at a trade. Its bottom tower is going to go down. But I think Newbie can still respond if they wanted to in mass teleports. But they're not going to go for it here. And I think it makes sense. They took a great fight earlier. There's no need to be greedy and continue to force these fights. They already got themselves a damn good trade. And better just angle for more of the mid game where they have the, well, first of all, the Spectre ultimate, I think, is still on cooldown. It is for another 45 seconds. But also, like, Morphling still needs, a big item. And that's going to be BKB. It's going to be his choice. Once they have that, they do have, I think, the ability to fight IG. But it's going to be under towers. I don't think they're still, like, really going to be aggressively looking for team fights. Maybe pickoffs with the Batrider. But otherwise, if 5-on-5 team fights should be occurring solely under newbies' towers.
That's exactly right. I mean, for all that we talked about Spectre's early game weakness having been mitigated a bit by the approach that they're taking, she really still does need another item up to be able to contribute what you want in these fights. And so this is a situation where Newbie are, you know, you're not happy about it, but you're willing to give up your tier 1 tower, especially if you're able to do this bot lane.
Drag back into the static storm, meaning Ferrari is unable to leap away and will be taken down by all the magic damage. Newbie finds the exact pickoff they're looking for here. The Batrider doing so well in lane, for me, was going to be the determining factor for Newbie, is whether or not they were going to find good pickoff here and there. And, unfortunately, IG just wastes a little bit of abilities there on an illusion of the Batrider.
And I believe you expressed some concern during the draft about the idea that, well, okay, Batrider's going to come in and he's got his lasso, but you've got some heroes on IG that do have some mobility. They're squishy, but they have some mobility. Well, the solution to that, of course, Static Storm. You lasso, you drag them right in, Disruptor drops that on their head, and they're dead. So I really like Newbie has a mixture of AoE and single target disable with their two supports, and this draft that I doubted is looking better and better.
Yeah, Newbie, I mean, the fact that right now the kill score is 3-10, they've got themselves a 4,000 gold lead, you got to be feeling really confident. IG, while you didn't expect them to crush the early game by any means, I think you did expect them to start coming online about 15 minutes, at least, very least find a couple of Chronosphere kills here and there. But as it is, Faceless Void has 2 deaths and has been part of 0 kills so far. How many Chronospheres has he thrown down? I've seen at least 1, possibly 2.
Yeah, there have been 2, and one of them was a part of that just disastrous gank attempt on Spectre on the bottom lane, and he's been forced to go for what is now a catch-up Midas. I don't think Ferrari necessarily started this game wanting to build Midas on his Void, although it's not bad, certainly, in the situation. But I actually think ordinarily, especially with the way the meta has played out recently, Spectre is the hero that you might want to see Midas on over and above Void. But in this situation, the fact that Void feels like he has to go Midas and Spectre feels like she can get that Vanguard up and then farm one more damage item and, hey guys, let's go fight, I actually think that that's a really good thing for Newbie right now.
Faith is going to be dragged back into the rest of the team. We do have Teleport, but it's not going to be in time. He gets off the Ice Blast, but they're not really going to be able to find anything else. Maybe Ember Spirit can actually grab Sonchang. Arrow's going to be able to lock him down. Well played, Chuan. Going to ensure that kill. The Chronosphere is going to come in. Can they get anything else off of this one? He's actually going to start focusing on Banana, trying to get himself away, but the Chronosphere only ensures a kill on the support hero and actually costs the Void his life in the process because there was just no response from the rest of the team. We already had, we saw Nature's Property just teleport to the top lane, so his teleport was on cooldown at that point in time. And you don't really have the damage here. I mean, as soon as you lose that big Ice Blast, where's the rest of your damage? Like, Chuan is still not level 9, which is where you have those maxed out nukes. So you actually do not have that amazing amount of damage just yet. So another tier 1 tower goes down, Newbie gaining more and more ground on IG.
I think related to the Void Midas discussion a second ago, a big window into how IG perceives their situation in this game, which I think is accurate, is that Chuan picked up a Midas on his Mirana, right? He is desperately far behind. He knows that the situation that we're in right now, they're not going to be able to make this mid-game team fight magic happen that they would have wanted to ideally when you draft this lineup. And so they say, okay, we do have four heroes on our team that have pretty good late game potential. Let's see if we can turtle this out. The Ice Blast is a pretty good tool for turtling anti-push as well as pushing lanes. They are going to try to make something happen here, but I'm not seeing what they're going to get done with this three-man gank top.
Oh, Luo, he's going to get picked off first. Moo's going to start going for him, and nicely played using the Adaptive Strike at the last second, while at the same time they do find the Spectre on the side of IG, which is actually a dominating streak going the way of Chuan. YYF is going to be held in place for the time being by Banana. I don't think they'll have enough, maybe with the Lasso and the Static Storm. They do get in range before YYF can jump away. Get out of the silence, buddy! He almost makes it, but Zhao Wei still burns him out at the last second, and the rest of Newbie will go in for the pursuit, but you can already see Chuan is teleporting himself out. And the Ancient Apparition has gotten away. Still worth it because they got that big spree on the Spectre. And I believe it went the way of Mirana. So,
right.
I would rather see it on the Ember Spirit, obviously. But, you know, it's still extra gold for somebody on the team of IG.
I'm not so sure. I mean, they were fortunate in that engagement that Spectre decided to go down from that top tier tower and farm the medium camp by the lane right as they were walking up the ramp smoked. So they were able to get a nice clean initiation, but they still weren't able to get a kill. Oh, boy.
They grab Hao, the tankiest hero on the team. They may actually be able to burst him down still, no matter what. Hao does shadow. Move. Trying to find some extra kills here, but the Moonlight Shadow is going to put a stop to that one. Gets the bash, Ferrari. First hit bash on call. Now chasing down Mu. He still has a lot of tank, though. He's trying to get himself away. He does have another waveform, but YYF and Ferrari both have the mobility to catch him. Sent back, though. The arrow snags on Mu. YYF doesn't have the damage, but he's still flame guarding. We'll get the burn onto Morphling. Now Batrider's going to jump in, ensure the kill onto Chuan. And I think that's going to be the end of the engagement as IG content themselves with both a Spectre and a Morphling kill. Very, very excellent fight for IG, what they really needed there.
Oh, huge. In terms of what IG needed to give them a chance, that's a huge fight for them. What do you think, Cap, about the BKB first build on the Morphling here?
I think it's something that if you're taking a look at Newbie's lineup, I think they needed to focus on the mid game, which is why neither Spectre nor Morphling go in for those really big ticket items. So Radiance for the Spectre, nor do we see an E-Blade for the Morphling. I don't think you can afford to go for those kind of items. I like the choice of them like actually going for more of these early game builds with both heroes. Their early game builds tend towards tanking up. So I do like it. And I think they still got plenty of time going into late game, but I think IG are making the most of the bad start they had, which is what you said earlier, focusing on the late game. I don't think they have the late game, but they certainly can put up a really good chance. They've got four different carries or semi carries. Newbie have the stronger carries, and they've got great utility behind them. But it's
building up to a huge engagement here.
Yeah, IG Faith. He actually does not have an Ice Blast. Just get but a beautiful Chronosphere. Oh! Now the Ice Blast over the top. Three heroes going to be hit by that. Moo is able to get off his BKB though, and that's going to put a stop to some of the Ice Blast. But they still might be able to get him if they're getting the right clicks. And finally, YYF gets a sleight of fist, beautiful teleport away from
the
Furion. And how? Well, he's got a dagger. He can actually try and get himself over the cliff. They do have some heroes that can pursue, but maybe just enough distance. Arrow not grabbing how. It goes down the cliff and doesn't manage to secure the kills. So two heroes still fall in exchange for the Ancient Apparition. IG really turning on their mid-game lineup now.
Awesome. And so this is the other side of that coin when I was asking you just now about the Morph BKB. Spectre has decided to turn around and go back for Radiance. And I don't mind this, but I think Newbie might have thought that they were a little bit more ahead than they really were, especially after that last gank on the Spectre happened top. And you can really see, again, exploiting those power spikes. You know, Void, with just his Mask of Madness up and a Midas, he can still do some real damage if he can get that Chrono off into an AI Splash.
No.
Oh man, huge.
The dagger was already out, and Hao was able to walk through the trees just barely. And the Orchid already did its tick damage.
from the Ice Blast, a small amount of damage that it did. It's nowhere near enough to be able to kill the Spectres. So both heroes, I think, going back to it again, it was necessary for both heroes to tank up, not only for mid-game reasons, but also that Ancient Apparition. Ancient Apparition, Faceless Void combination. Just like that by itself is a killer if you're not tanky enough. So
and they're actually we see that this is a big Rosh, yeah. Go ahead.
We had the Furion already have his Treants in there, so they know the wards were used. So they know there's a certain amount of commitment here by Newbie. They're going to make sure the Roshan isn't given away for free. It's a little bit below half health right now. Jiaowei is sitting on the side waiting for a pickoff here. But it's a pretty smart decision here from IG. Newbie know where IG is going to be coming in from, but if they smoke up, it means they won't be able to find the opportunity to strike first, and that's exactly what they're going for here. Hao, he's going to be focused on. Great sheep there from Ferrari. Hao walking himself away, but he's still going to go down in the end. Now waveform in, Ferrari getting low, but he is backtracking some of it. Not quite enough to live, though. Mu trying to get himself away. Xiaowei aggressively pushing forward, and they're actually going to go for Fate here. The squishy hero arrow lands on Mu. Maybe they can turn this around. Chuan's getting low, but both Luo as well as Fate are actually going for this kill. Orchid up on Mu, but he's still morphing into strength. Couple right clicks and one more. Faith is actually going to be able to get it.
Oh,
and just this last one finally gets it in the end. We have Furion going down both Shan Shang as well as Zhao 8. And they're now chasing down Faith. Mirana's making his way over, but he's not going to be here in time. At the very least, he will be able to ensure that the Roshan won't be done. It's already reaching end up. It got so low, too. But they already buy back on the Mirana. They're buying back on the Ancient Apparition as well. I think they're really scared that Roshan's going to be done here by this Spectre. So they're trying to get as many troops on the field as soon as humanly possible to make sure that Roshan still is contested by them.
Yeah, and I thought both teams played that engagement really, really well. I mean, obviously, Void, he had to one-man Chrono the Spectre, which is not ideal to say the least. That led to only really a one-man Ice Blast, but he felt like he had to do that because an Aegis on either the Spectre or the Morphling at this point means that Newbie can really just get at least two towers, if not threaten the base.
Yeah, they can't kill him without the Ice Blast. Oh, beautiful! The arrow lands on Jiaowei. They're going to be able to pick up that kill nice and easy. San Shang now held inside the Sprout. That's a secondary kill for IG. And did they just get enough control to be able to go for Roshan? No! They do have buybacks. This is risky. IG, I can't believe they're going for this. They're going to try and secure the Aegis real quickly, Newbie. No Spectre Ultimate going down. It was up, but they opt not to try and use it there. The initiation just was not quite ready for Newbie. Now the Chronosphere is going to be able to lock down Mu. Arrow over the top, and that's a huge amount of burst damage, getting one. Newbie on the pursuit now. They're still going to go for it with Hao actually coming back in with his ultimate. He's going to go for Ferrari. They will be able to get that kill as the Aegis falls. Question is, what else can Newbie do around this? Can they actually hold in? Faceless Void long enough? No, where's the disabled banana? He had shackles but didn't get off in time, and without the ward damage, I don't think they can get this kill. Ferrari's getting low here, but if he has enough backtracks, I think he can still survive. Hao has to be careful. He's taking the damage from Lua, but it's still enough. He's tanky enough to be able to deal with that damage. They're still on pursuit for more. Furion gonna get picked off, as well as the glimpse onto YYF, but beautiful use of the remnants. Will be able to get himself away as the Static Storm was on cooldown from earlier. So in the end, IG, they at least take away the Roshan advantage for a Newbie. I think in the end, the commitment to Roshan was good for them. They also got a Morphling kill. Obviously, if you think back, you know, hindsight being 2020, they shouldn't have gone for that engagement on the Morphling, but I think any other team would have chosen to take that fight there. Batrider is going to have a four staff in a short amount of time. We also have the Disruptor who's going to have a, well, not, actually, I forgot, he bought back. I was going to say a full Ags there because I looked at him not too long ago and he had 1,800 gold, but that's no longer going to be the case after that buyback. He's working towards the Ags eventually, but it's going to be a while now. Battle Fury full up now for the Ember Spirit. That's a big, big growth of damage there for IG. They were lacking damage a little bit earlier, but now with all the kills going their way, they've got a full amount of experience. They've caught up beautifully. Look at that gold lead. It has jumped up quite a bit. Only a 2,000 gold lead now for Newbie, and about the same in experience. And what's even better, one of the things I love about Hand of Midas for Faceless Void is the fact that I feel Faceless Void is very dependent on levels, mainly because his ultimate is such a great utility ability that you want to be able to have the lowest cooldown possible. So only 80 seconds cooldown on the Chronosphere is wonderful. And with the BKB as well, it ensures pretty much every single time they have a free kill. Every single Chronosphere that is laid down, they get an Ice Blast over the top,
and faces Void, pops his BKB, and makes sure he doesn't get disabled. That's a kill. I don't care if it's Spectre, I don't care if it's the Morphling. Either one of those heroes, despite the fact that they're tanky, are still going to fall to that kind of right-click damage with the Shatter over the top. Looks like I may have lost Nahaz for a little bit. Yeah, we have a problem with the call. So, give him a call back in just a second here. What other big items do we have? Shotgun is going to be gone on by the Morphling. We already had the Spectre picking up the Radiance, and now is going to be going for the Manta. Pretty typical build for a Spectre. And what else do they have on their side? The Force Staff, Ghost Scepter. No real big ticket items, whereas IG, obviously winning a couple engagements in a row, are getting big upgrades on their side. They still have to be worried a little bit about the late game for newbie, but they've certainly addressed that issue as much as they can. Like Chuan going for the Midas, so he's going to be going for semi-carry build. Ember Spirit and Faceless Void are both late game carries that can rival both the Spectre as well as the Morphling. It's all going to come down to the execution in the late and super late game. Give Nahaz another call here as the Moonlight Shadow comes out from IG. And, well, not finding anybody just yet. If they continue to go into the jungle, they may be able to find one of newbie, but looks like that's going to be just kind of a wreck smoke gank from IG. Both teams not really having a clear advantage after that Roshan engagement, so they may both decide to back themselves up and farm. Newbie, definitely, because they still need that Ethereal Blade for the Morphling. That makes a big difference in a lot of these engagements. So they probably want to sit back and farm, at least for Mu. But I'm trying to think. I don't think Spectre, like Manta, it's a decent item, obviously. It's obviously adds in a lot for the Spectre with the Radiance, and the additional tank is going to be helpful, but it isn't huge. It's not one of those items where you wait a couple minutes for. I think it's mainly that E-Blade for the Morphling that's going to be the next upgrade for them. As far as IG, expect to see a Chrysalis next for Ahri. That has been the typical build for Faceless Voids. And YYF, he may build a Chrysalis as well. This is usually the branching point for a lot of Ember Spirits. The standard build is usually Phase Boots Drums. You grab a Battle Fury as your first damage item. But this is where you're going to branch off into either the late game or the super late game. Like, if you want damage immediately, you usually go for Chrysalis into an inevitable Daedalus, so you have that opportunity to get those big crits. But if you want to be oriented more towards the late game, I'm sure you've all seen those stats for Battle Fury. Battle Fury is, if you go double or triple Battle Fury, it's usually your more late game item. I would say double Battle Fury. I don't think triple Battle Fury is excessive. Double Battle Fury into the Daedalus after that, I would say, would be more of your farming build. Another smoke gank from IG. They might just wander into Moon here. Moonlight Shadow being used. Moon, did he see anybody? I don't think he did. IG also didn't see him at the same time. Unfortunate. Because again, just the Chronosphere into the arrow, into the Ice Blast. That's enough to kill any hero on newbie right now. Ancient Apparition. That, like, as good as the Aghanim's upgrade for Disruptor is, it's sort of situational in that, like, you need to be able to catch out those heroes before they pop the BKBs, right? If you use it afterwards, after the BKB, it does very little. This Ice Blast will always be strong for Faith. He's going to have so many more opportunities. One of the best, if not the best, Aghanim's upgrade in the game. This Ancient Apparition, it's always strong. Even going to the super late game, 15 seconds for that 12% shatter is just amazing. It pretty much ensures if you get a five-man Shatter Man or a five-man Ice Blast to lead a team fight, I would be surprised as hell if you don't win. Dude, I hope you guys are enjoying the Zoom feature as much as I am. I have been waiting for this for so damn long, and I am having so much fun playing around with it. In some of these team fights or being able to like mark certain territories in the map, it is what we've needed for a very long time. Been so jealous of StarCraft because of that exact reason. I don't know, we have some sort of internet issues every single time I call Nahaz. It's like, no, that's no good. Oh, Chronosphere up in the top lane. Ice Blast is going to be able to land onto Hau, especially with that extra bit of lockdown. Free kill for Ferrari. Sure, he committed a BKB just to ensure that
there was going to be no, like, blink Shatter Shaman nonsense. But he just leaps himself away at that point. Find the three pickoff. And IG, if they want to, they could probably just five-man down mid and take this tier two. Every single time they find a pickoff like that, they can either push down mid and force that buyback or push down mid and take a tower. You can already see the attempt here from the split push for IG. The Furion doing what
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
How's our Morphling doing? He's almost to the Ethereal Blade. That's going to add that crucial popping power up against heroes like the Ancient Apparition. Hell, even the Piranha is still really squishy. I mean, you typically go for Maelstrom first if you're going to be going for some sort of semi-carry Marana. It's a great farming item for you, but it leaves you extremely susceptible to that kind of burst damage. And Morphling, man, he can take him down in just one shot. Got to be aware of that. Zhao Wei, well, he's got everything he needs as a Bat Rider. But he can always build into some additional items, such as Yule Scepter and things like that. Hell, even an E-Blade. E-Blade would actually be a great item, I would say, for Batrider to have if he does get that huge amount of influx of gold. I would say an E-Blade would be excellent for him because it's always good versus some of those melee carries, and you can use it in those scenarios where Ferrari has Chronosphered one of your carries and is trying to focus him down with the Ice Blast. Sure, it's going to allow the Ice Blast to do extra damage, and that sucks, but it's worth it if you can actually make your target ethereal and the Faceless Void is unable to target him because of that.
Yeah, that's actually a really good point. So sorry to our viewers, I just literally hard crashed and I'm just now loading back in, but actually I think I saw EE do that on his Draw Ranger the other day in the DreamHack finals, built kind of a defensive E-Blade on his Drow.
Yeah, I can't. I was like looking at it, it's going like, damn, E-Blade on Drow Ranger. That's pretty interesting, but I actually really like it. It's a defensive item, but also, like, you think about it, like, Drow Ranger gets all that extra agility anyway. It's kind of hilariously just trolly in a way that you have so much agility that just the E-Blade by itself, even if you have no nukes extra on the Drow Ranger, it still does a ton of damage.
Oh, and Faceless Void with the Diffusal here. This is an interesting pickup. What do we think about this?
So stopping the Ghost Scepters, man. That's all about. I was going to say, like, no Diffusals. So Ghost Scepters and E-Blades, all gravy. But now with this pickup from Ferrari, he does have that's really the last key because he always has BKB. So inside of Chronosphere, there's nothing that will stop him. There's no disables to stop him. And now with that purge, there's nothing to be able to save the ally either.
I agree with that for the record. Diffusal Blade is not a bad DPS item on him, but the utility factor is really what you're going for. You know, if you're going to build Void as more of a utility hero than a late game carry, as we've talked about, I think that kind of an item is really important. You got to rethink those item builds just a little bit.
Yeah, I'm waiting for the Aghanim Scepter for him. Like, I'm still expecting a Chrysalis, but I'm wondering if he's actually going to go for an Aghanim Scepter, which has been pretty prevalent in late-game carry voids. It's always a great item for you to have.
Well, but you're seeing it moved up in his build order, though, and it's a little bit, the timing is a little bit awkward right now.
Zhao Wei, he's going to go for a pickoff onto Ferrari, trying to pull him back, but the chains holds him in place for the time being. Can they still get Ferrari? He actually gets the Static Storm on top of that. We'll be able to finish him off. We do have Furion in the mix, popping his BKB. Hao is trying to find one hero to address here, but nobody's actually going to go down. Oh, no. He gives him a small bit of adaptive strike to slow down that teleport, and we'll be able to get an additional kill, and Faith gets hexed up as well. So they do get two additional kills off the back of the pickoff onto the Faceless Void. Three heroes go down, and Newbie now able to finish up Roshan. The attempt of an initiation there from IG just falls to pieces with Zhao Wei having that gem.
Well, yeah, and it was the Disruptor Static Storm has just played such a huge role in this game, and that's the downside of a utility Void, is if you don't get that perfect Chrono initiation, he's really very, very vulnerable, because even with Backtrack, right, your Void is not exactly a tanky hero right now.
Newbie are now going to be going for the five-man push down middle lane. I think they've got
a big enough advantage. IG are actually ahead. We're ahead in gold and experience, but off of that team fight, it's obviously going to drop down pretty heavily. I think Newbie with that Aegis should be trying to take the rest of these tier twos. We're looking at like a good 60, maybe even 80 minute game though, man. I don't feel that Newbie really going to be able to take that team fight and do anything extra off of just taking gold away from IG.
I think you're probably right, but I'm still not sure, given that you've got three Midases on the side of IG, you've got some heroes on Newbie that can fight right now. I think you're probably right that they fall back and farm. It's the safe thing to do, but I'm not so sure if I'm Newbie that I don't try to do a little bit more with this Aegis than it looks like they're going to.
Yeah, I would say at the very least they should be taking tier twos. And
I agree.
Looking at Chinese teams, I would say they probably aren't going to try and push uphill with the Aegis off of that. But I do think it's a possibility for them. I just don't expect Newbie to do it just because they're just their playstyle. Chrysalis was picked up by the Ember Spirit. Ferrari, well, he's only got 1,000 gold since his Diffusal Blade pickup. We do have Chuan with him Mjolnir now. And what item is coming in? TP Skulls. So nothing major.
Yeah, the Mjolnir, though, is just a fantastic pickup, though, because that lightning shield on the Void is really gonna don't underestimate the damage output there. Both Spectre, who's melee, and Morphling, who's a relatively short range carry, that's potentially a lot of damage output on them in the fights. And we're already getting to the point where the Morphling's BKB is already down to 6 seconds, so that's not necessarily gonna shield him from those lightning procs.
Hopefully they'll be able to prioritize Faith a little bit more in the next couple of minutes. He just needs another 350 gold for his Aghanim's upgrade.
Aghanim's, yeah. And that's a really, really big deal. Yeah, that's the item where if you're IG, one of the reasons that I like their position right now is because they've got the three Midases. They're certainly well positioned if we go into that 60, 80 minute late game that you described. Okay, let me backtrack a little bit because I was going to spend some time talking about the AA Aghanims, and arguably the much more important support Aghanims is the Disruptor. Oh my goodness, the AoE Doom potential here. And yeah, they are going to try and make something. This is, I think, the right answer. They were waiting for the Aghanims on the Disruptor. That's the piece of the puzzle I was missing. And they're going to try and make something happen with that AoE Doom and the Aegis.
Yeah, they're going to go at least take the tier 2 bottom, possibly rotate to take the tier 2 at the top lane as well. Off of this, yeah, the pick-off potential is real right now because Zhao Wei will always be able to grab somebody and bring them back. Presumably, he gets the lasso before BKB goes off, and then there will always be a static storm on top of that. So if he always orients himself to try and grab Ferrari before Ferrari initiates, like he did in that last Roshan teamfight. If he grabs Ferrari and drags him back, even if they have no other extra damage except the Disruptor is going to be enough because he's going to throw down that Static Storm and Faceless Void will still not be able to throw down his BKB even after the lasso fades. So it's going to be an extremely long amount of disable for that Faceless Void. So he's going to have to be really careful with his positioning. And I think vision is actually one of the keyest parts of this whole entire mid-game right now is that Newbie, they've got that vision advantage at all times because they have Firefly. Like, Firefly is an amazing ability, especially in these kind of corridors where you're always going to be able to find that initiation. Vision is what allows you to be the initiator onto team fights, and if Newbie are initiating, I think they win the team fight easily. If the Chronosphere is the initiation, then IG take it rather easily.
No, I think, yeah, I actually really love that last point that you made because a lot of people, I think there are just so many aspects of Batrider's kit that are underrated, and I've talked before about the turn rate slow on Sticky Napalm just being so powerful, but the vision from Firefly is another thing. And the other thing that I was going to say is a lot of people kind of don't like these games that are sort of knife edge, and whichever team gets the better initiation, you can have one team fight Radiant's that decides the game. I love this. It's just the tension is palpable, right? Whichever team, either Chrono into Ice Blast or Lasso into AoE, into Static Storm with Aghanims, it's just awesome, right? Knowing that the pressure is on these players and these teams Radiant's to execute so perfectly fallen within the next few minutes of this game. I am not at all sure that we're going to have that 80-minute farm fest, but we'll see.
We're going to see in just a minute here whether or not Newbie actually choose to use this last bit of Aegis timing to actually try and go uphill, or if they fall back, farm up the map, and angle for the next Roshan. They do have IG. They're letting newbie make the first move. You saw the spread earlier. I tried to show that as much as possible. Thanks to this lovely zoom feature, but you could see the spread of newbie. They realize how important it is just to be able to have the Spectre up front. And that is how they're going to be pushing uphill as well, is because the Spectre with the Aegis as well as the Heart is super tanky. And they can afford to let him go down. Even after he has the Aegis go down, as long as he has a buyback, they can still have Hal be that front runner, because if he is targeted by the Chronosphere Ice Blast combination, he goes down, he's going to buy back and come right back with his Haunt. And that is one of the best late game possibilities for a Spectre, is that when you're on the offensive, you're still able to instantly be back in the team fight, just like a Furion can.
Yeah, so he's effectively got two, and arguably with Aegis, although he just lost it, he's going to have three lives. And what you said is very important, because we saw earlier in one of the engagements in the Roche pit that Void time walked in and single man chronoed the Spectre backed up by the Ice Blast. They did end up losing that engagement, but that's just an illustration of how disastrously badly this will go for IG if you get in and you catch only Spectre or maybe one other hero in the Chrono. You really have to catch either of the Shadow Shaman or the Disruptor, and preferably both in the Chrono, along with one of those other core heroes, or the engagement can go really, really badly, even if you are the ones on the attack.
So newbie are taking their time. The Aegis didn't have a whole lot of timing on it anyway, so they backed themselves up. IG, knowing the timing on the Aegis, are now going to smoke up and push forward as a five-man crew and see if they can start taking some map control of their own. If they find a pick off here, they can start controlling these lanes and take some tier twos of their own. You know, they don't want to, at this point, you know, 45 and a half minutes in, the tower lead isn't as big of a deal, but it's still
this
something
is huge
significant
right here.
Gold left. Yeah, smoke is going to be popped here. They're going to run into Hal. That's not the hero they really want to go for first. Ice Blast over the top, and it will connect there, even if it isn't actually the blast itself. They quickly get the Spectre, but here comes that buyback. The Chronosphere is going to be able to lock down Zhao Wei, holding him while YYF is held in place as well. Ember Spirit's going to go down in a second, but he gets off a big. Oh, that Ember Spirit sleight of fist does some serious amount of work before he makes the jump away. Newbie actually on their way to pursue. They do get Ferrari in the end, but they didn't get that Ember Spirit, which is the crucial kill. He made the jump away and is actually going to be there to defend up against newbie. Just that small amount of time where he was able to get off that sleight of fist, because they were so grouped up, that Battle Fury did a ton of work to newbie, and he actually made the jump away. So in the end, like, he's still up, he's still going to be able to provide some defense, especially with a couple of buybacks coming out. But newbie certainly taking a big advantage off of that team fight, and are going to try and press it for as many buybacks as possible. They do still have the buyback up for the Faceless Void, but they're waiting for an opportunity to actually buy back and make some sort of jump. Zhao Wei is going to be picking off Chuan, even as the arrow landed on Mu. And I think they realize they can't do anything without Chronosphere, so they're not even trying to buy back on the Faceless Void right now.
Yeah, and this is a really big turning point in that game, and you know, I pat yourself on the back, Cap, for talking about that that buyback haunt option, because that really was what decided that last fight. Had a pretty good initiation there. The static storm was okay, but wasn't ideal. But they were able to get the Spectre. But then the Spectre comes right back in, and IG just doesn't have the kind of sustained damage output, even with the Battle Fury and the Crystallis on the Ember Spirit, and some spectacular plays in terms of positioning and his sleight of fist during that fight. They don't have the sustained damage output to take down the Spectre twice while still coping with the rest of the abilities from newbie. So I think newbie with that fight takes a really, really big edge in this game, and it was as close. Both the gold and the XP graphs were as close as you can possibly be right leading up to that fight, and I thought it was the right idea by IG to smoke up and try and make something happen. But again, just great execution, as we've been saying time and time again, by the newbie side.
Yeah, it was just so unfortunate that of all the heroes that they ran into in that situation, it was the Spectre first. And you obviously are going to go on the first hero you come onto. You don't try and really leap past that, especially since you don't know what else is actually over there. So they go for the Spectre first. What happens? Buyback. They have a huge advantage. They easily win the team fight. If IG had lost YYF in that situation, though, I would say that newbie probably could have gone for two sets of racks.
Yes.
And probably actually been able to force a bite, and that could have been a whole entire GG. But because he lived, there was just enough for newbie
that they were just able to take one Rax and didn't really push the advantage past that. And I think that was one of the only fortunate scenarios there from IG. Ferrari almost blowing his Chronosphere there onto the Morphing Illusion. Zhao Wei looking for that pickoff now. He's going to pop his BKB right away, but going to be caught in the Chronosphere at the same time we have the Ice Blast coming in. He's going to be able to take him down. IG are being wrecked by the Spectre right now, though. All of them taking that Radiance damage. Looks like Hal's going to be going for YYF at the same time. Ferrari being controlled by those two supports plus Mu as the carry. Now Lu is going to be blown up, and Chuan goes down as well. YYF, the last hero left alive for IG. He may get taken down here. Unfortunately, the disables were not up for newbie, but we don't have buybacks on certain heroes for IG, and I think this is one of the critical things here, is that if they bought back on the Faceless Void, this game would be over for IG. So even though they keep losing the fights, they're making all the smaller, the right small decisions to still barely keep themselves in the game. Otherwise, newbie just would have ended the game already.
Well, I mean, they're stopping the patient from bleeding out, but yeah. I think he's still in critical condition, my friend.
Absolutely.
I think they're gonna take Roche, and I just don't see how IG is gonna be able to repel this newbie death push, because they've shown what the important thing is. They've shown in the last couple of fights that they can cope with that Chronosphere Ice Blast combo, and I am wondering a little bit in that last engagement about the Void's decision to try and focus the Batrider in the Chronosphere rather than the Disruptor to prevent the AoE Doom, but I don't think that the fight would have gone in their favor either way.
Yeah, agreed. Newbie do have a significant advantage. I think at this point, like IG, this is where they're oriented. Like that, we talked about it really early on, about 15 minutes in, I would say, where IG were orienting themselves more for the late game. They knew they weren't really going to be able to take over the mid game as much as they really wanted to. They wouldn't be able to end the game by any means, so they chose to go for more of the late game option, which is where you see the Mirana. Now, the Mirana still is not up, really. Like, the Mirana is still being burnt out by the Spectre every single time. You can't just sit there as the Mirana and tank those hits, so it means when she's running away from the Spectre ultimate, she's, like, all that damage that she has with Mjolnir, Crystallis, even a Morbid Mass being picked up for some reason, I guess a little bit of sustain, but all that damage is doing nothing for you because the Spectre is forcing you to play just, you know, run away.
Yeah, that's absolutely right. And you do, just a quick point, I feel like I got to correct myself a little bit because I mentioned before that two engagements ago that the gold graph was basically even, but you've got to respect the fact that the reason for that is because IG has three Midases on their side. When you've got a three minus team, you need to be ahead at this point, not even, right? Yeah. Because so much of that gold is tied up in those
Dire's
minuses.
Top tower is under attack.
You're going to see newbie start going for a secondary tier three, and with the Shadow Shaman wards Radiant easily being able to take it. And IG, they know this is their last fight here. If they lose this one, they are done for. So they're just trying to find some sort of opening. But you can see newbie again setting themselves very far back, while the Hao is just way up front, because they know Hao is so tanky that if they start going on him, he's got Aegis. He also will probably have a buyback. In fact, he does have a buyback already. So he has three lives in this team. Yeah. Like, not like three lives, like, oh, he comes back and he's going to teleport to a tower and run his way in. No, three lives where he's basically instantly back in the team fight, which is just absurd. IG have to push this game so late where the Faceless Void is maxed out, where the Ember Spirit, the Furion, and the Mirana are all maxed out if they have a hope of being able to take newbie, because the late game carries, man, they're both the Spectre and the Morphling are some of the best late game carries you can ask for.
Absolutely. And you're seeing newbie do in this game what IG did in the last game. They know they have the advantage. They know what the situation in the game is. And so they're just kind of slow siege, and they're able to take a tier 3 tower and a Rax, their melee Rax, without much risk.
Saw that opportunity. We're going to see Zhao Wei actually pull YYF once again. YYF is not going to be held inside the static storm. He's going to walk himself away. Can he actually get out, Remnant? No, not enough. Ferrari's going to go for Son Shank, but the disruption's already been blown. The Disruptor ultimate static storm, he doesn't care if he dies, he's already used it. Ferrari goes down as well, and that is going to be it, I think. IG losing three heroes in quick succession to newbie and only claiming a support in the process. All that's left is newbie just to be able to run down mid
and claim this throne. We do have, I believe, a couple of buybacks.
I don't get why you fight outside your base as IG there, but you're in a desperate situation. You got to make something happen, so I'm not going to be too hard on them for it, but I just don't know. Anytime, to me, a fight occurs outside your base in that situation, it's a failure. You got to give the other team a chance to throw, even though they're probably not going to. The GGs come out, and man, I'm telling you, these last two games, what a pleasure watch. I felt like both teams played really, really well. Newbie obviously takes the series, and they had the better game three, but I think these last two games just have everything that you could have asked for, and really bode well for these two teams going into TI4.
Yeah, IG, they did what they could. Honestly, that last push, like, just the way they lost that bottom racks, man, was just so rough, because they couldn't do anything about it. How? So I guess they went ahead and made that decision to go, you know what, if we're not going to let ourselves get slow sieged again, we're going to go out with a bang. If we win the team fight, we hold on to this game. If we lose, it's all over. And sure enough, with that kind of initiation, once again, the initiation going the way of Newbie. Every single time, it felt like they were getting the better initiation. The Batrider was always able to get the jump, excluding the one time that IG were actually the initiators, which was in that top jungle fight where they were smoked up and they ran into Hao of all heroes. Like, if it wasn't Hao, you just think about how different this game could have been if Hao wasn't farther to the right. You know, if he was with the rest of his team and the Chronosphere caught multiple heroes and they could have, you know, actually changed their target a little bit and gone for someone else, you know, kid, take out the Disruptor, take out the Batrider. Those two heroes, really, really key. Or hell, even kill the Morphling, one of the carries that isn't going to come back in the fight instantly. They could have had a chance to be able to win that and kept their map control and push this game a little bit later where maybe they have a shot. But as it is, it just somehow it feels like it all comes down to one team fight.
No, I think I gotta say though that the Batrider Disruptor combo to me was the kind of the co-MVPs of this game. I felt like they just got so much out of that, both in terms of being able to pick off one hero and in terms of being able to just dictate and zone the entire team fight. That combination was so effective for them, and it was really fun. Again, I call Zhao 8 cerebral because I think the way he approaches the game is just so intelligent in terms of exploiting the angles on the map and in team fight engagements, and I thought that was on full display here for Newbie, who's just looking like an absolute juggernaut over the last couple of weeks.
All right, guys. Well, that's going to be it for now. We actually do have another match that's going to be coming up. It is actually going to be on Daily Motion. We have the Dota 2 Champions League. That is going to be happening here. And I believe it's at 17 CEST. Hold on here. I had to actually look it up because Toby's logged in. It's actually in an hour and 10 minutes. Oh, my God. So it's starting nice and early. 17 CEST. We have Alliance versus Fnatic in the Dota 2 Champions League playoffs. You definitely want to be able to tune into that because that's two of the top Western teams in the semifinals. This will determine who moves on to the finals to face up against Power Rangers and who will drop down to the third place decider to face up against PR. So Empire in the finals, Alliance and Fnatic in the semis right now, and Power Rangers in that third place matchup. That is current standings for Dota 2 Champions League. That's going to be coming up in just an hour, so be sure to just go to joindota.com. We have that nice little link at the top right, live and upcoming tab, where you're going to see the countdown, and you'll be able to just click on Join Dota DM, and it'll take you straight to the stream. So guys, thanks again for tuning in. Thanks to Nahaz, at Nahaz Dota, my statsman slash co-caster for the last two games. And, of course, a big shout-out to you guys for making this game such a success in viewing numbers. So, Newbie will move on to the C-Deck. IG will actually be dropping down into the lower bracket, so they're not out of the tournament entirely. They're going to be dropping down to face up against, I believe, HGT. It's either HGT or LGD C-Deck, one of the two, but... Guys, thanks for tuning in. We'll see you guys in just an hour for Alliance versus Fnatic.